Hey there. Yeah, I'm going to show just some positions. I think I got five, just a small selection. It's going to be a short video. Some interesting positions. I think they're all end games, but I can't remember that I picked from round one of the Lichess4545 League. I already analyzed the games of our team, but I found some other games with some interesting highlights, and I wanted to share, just these five positions. So first one we're going to have a look at is MQJ against RTN 12. Can't remember what the teams were, and I don't have it on the PGN. So let's just move on to the position I wanted to share, which is here. And this is a very interesting endgame. White just took something on h3. I think it was a pawn. So king takes h3, which is a very, very not just a natural move, but good move. And this is the situation. We have an endgame that is very equally material, two pawns versus two pawns, king and bishop, king against king and bishop. And if, for example, the bishops were opposite colors, it would be a draw no matter what. But the fact that the bishops are the same color makes at least one side have more hopes than the other to win here. If you're not familiar with this kind of endgame, please pause the video and think which side do you think has the chances to win here and why, and what should each of them be doing. All right. Now the answer is a black could have some chances to win here, as Stockfish confirms. I'm not going to show you the Stockfish analysis, but you can see the bar. And the reason black may win here is the situation of the pawns. White has... there's also something to be said about the situation of the kings, of course. Black's king is slightly better than white's king because it's closer to the pawns, can already start attacking. White is close to defending, but that's a very passive spot. It's not so close to, for example, counter-attacking. So the kings are relevant, definitely, but if we only look at the bishops, as I said earlier, if the bishops were opposite colors, position of the kings wouldn't be that relevant. Also, if the bishops were opposite colors, if the pawns were the other color, and the good bishop was white's, then the position of the kings wouldn't be relevant either. But in this case, white has some trouble because his bishop is not good. It's no bueno. It's hitting the own pawns and can never attack these pawns because they're on a different color. Conversely, black's bishop can attack these white pawns. So for instance, king e4, bishop e3 could be a plan to target this weakness here. However, that weakness can be defended, right? It's already defended once and can be defended twice with the king on g5, for instance, which, by the way, would be a great square to have some counterplay. So that's what white will ideally try to do. Go up king h4, king g5. That would be an ideal scenario. So what happened in the game was a draw. And I wanted to bring this because it was a very interesting endgame, because there's only one way to win for black, and it's not immediately obvious. But if you think what each side wants to do, then it becomes sort of apparent what you have to do. So if we go as in the game, king e4 was played, and the plan is, as I said, to attack this, but white will defend it properly and also start counter-attacking. When then, if you have to go back with the king, then you're no longer attacking f4, and that's going to be a draw, which in the game happened, of sorts. So let's first see what happened in the game. King e4, which is already a mistake, but it's not yet threatening the pawn, but it's starting to attack it, maybe trying to play bishop e3 next. Now, as white, we don't have a choice. We have to go king h4, because that's the only way to really defend the pawn twice. If we go to g3, we block our own bishop, and after bishop e3, we're going to just lose the pawn. So king h4 is forced, and then after, well, a check was delivered, king went up, and king went completely completely solid. Black here was like, no counterplay at all, so it's an immediate draw, because there's no way to make progress for either of them. And then, yeah, they played some moves, but this position is completely drawn. And here they agreed to a draw, I think. Let's go back to this position after king takes h3 instead of king e4. What could black have tried to try and win this position? Well, we said white's only way to save the pawn, to defend it properly, is king h4, king g5. So can we prevent king h4? Yes, we can. There's only one move to prevent king h4. Bishop f2, exclamation mark. That's the winning move. Bishop f2. It's a funny move to find. It's not maybe the first move that comes to mind. But, you know, when you have an advantage, you have to be... like in this case, the advantage is never going to go away, right? The pawns are going to be blocked on dark squares, so our bishop is going to be a good bishop compared to the opponents. Our king is in good shape, is near the pawns, ready to attack. So our advantage is not going to be gone. What we need to do is first stop the defensive resource of the opponent. And now the defensive resource of king h4, king g5 is no longer there, and now we win. So it feels simple when you look at it, but yeah, king h4 is not possible. And for instance, let's say the king goes to g2, because that's its only other legal move. We can go king e2, really works, but king e3 already attacking the pawn. Let's say the king moves again, and now, for instance, king e4 works, because again king h4 is not possible. So next move, we're going to go bishop e3, and white will not have time to play two moves. So we're going to collect this pawn, we're going to collect that pawn, we're going to win. So very, very interesting. There's also, of course, we have to mention that all the king and pawn endgames are lost for white due to the position of the kings. So bishop g3 maybe could have been what a human would have tried, but we can simply simplify. Actually, we have to, because otherwise king h4. So we have to simplify, and now this endgame is, of course, winning. After this move, we're going to collect that. I have to mention, for those of you who are not very experienced with endgames, this position, without these two pawns, would be a draw. Funnily enough. Because after king e3, imagine the position without those two pawns. King e3 wins the pawn. Wins the pawn f4. But it wouldn't win the game if these pawns were not here. Because after king g2, king takes, and king f2 winning the opposition, if these pawns were not here, it would be a draw. It would be a king and pawn versus king drawn endgame. Except here, of course, two pawns up, it's a win. All right, so that was a very interesting moment. A miss by Artyang here, who could have won the game, but it was, of course, hard to spot. What's another interesting game? We have Leon 88 versus J123DH. And here, let me go to move 72. King f6. Right. So here we have what it should be a drawn endgame. And okay, if one side can win, it's going to be white. Because white is a pawn up. terrible things should happen for black to win this. So yeah, it's basically a two results position, but it should be a draw. Why should it be a draw? Because the only dangerous pawn, this one, is already blocked by the king. So if we imagine this position, for instance, without these pawns on the h-file, it's an immediate draw, very easy draw to make. So, you know, if we add maybe a couple pawns somewhere else, could be dangerous, but the rook pawns are not the most dangerous ever. And also this rook is active. So for instance, this rook may try already to play against this pawn. We have to be careful, of course, because rook g4, there's h5, and we may actually be losing there. So, okay, we have to be cautious here as black. For instance, another way to lose here would be to keep the rook on the 7th rank. In the game, that wasn't played. But also, a mistake was played. And, yeah, here we're not making any progress, and white could simply approach the pawn and then try for a rook trade. So this is a very interesting endgame because you have to count tempi. For instance, if you go rook e7 first, trying, you know, to trade rooks, give up this pawn, take this pawn, and promote this pawn, that seems like a plan, but you have to count it correctly. And here, if you count, black is actually drawing this. So take, take, take. I think there's a rule for this, the distance of the kings. We're a file too far, but this pawn needs to be pushed too much. So black is actually in time. Let's imagine king f7, king runs, king here, king runs, king takes. And, sorry, let's be clever as black instead. Let's not keep running because then we lose. Let's play h5. And now king here, king here, king takes, king there, and we're in time to get to the g8 safe square that will make the draw. Because the only way to prevent king g8 here, the only way, if we start pushing king g8, king h8, draw. So the only way to prevent king g8 is king h7, but then we're trapped in front of our own pawn. The king can move up and down. We're going to move up and down to block the king, so the king can't go out. And if the pawn is pushed, so we lose the opposition, we always go up. Although here, king f6 also works, because king g8 is king g5. But there's no reason to complicate ourselves. We're going to be always there in those two squares. So if he goes away, we can enter g8. And if he doesn't go away, well, we're caging that king in front of the pawn, and it's a draw. So that's the kind of endgame they should both be calculating, what happens when the rooks get traded. And honestly, if it was me, without calculating, I would play h5. Because I don't see, you know, rook d7 is a very passive move, it's not a threat. So I don't see what's black's play, so I would just simply win a tempo in all those endgames, and we're going to be a tempo closer to winning. I don't know if the race was winning already or not, but I know that after h5, I have more chances than it's winning. Anyway, that did not happen. And black here played a move that is also a mistake. Played rook g1. And in the end, many errors happen here in this game. For instance, now the only winning move, can you guess it? H5, yes, H5 is the winning move, because again, we want this pawn as closer as possible, and then all the endgames where we cash, when we collect the H pawn, are going to be winning. So this pawn is there, we're gonna keep it defended as much as we can to keep this king as far from the H file as long as possible, and we want to push this as much as possible. That's what will give us less tempi necessary to win in those races. So yeah, here h5 was winning, and that's the reason rook g1 was a mistake. But h5 wasn't played, so yeah, many blunders on both sides. The only move to draw, and this is funny, okay, maybe it's not funny, because we already discussed that after rook d7, h5 wins, because rook e7 does not suffice to win. And once we already decided that with the pawns here on h5, h7, b6, the rook trade does not win, it's more or less simple to know what's black's drawing move here, I guess. I guess it's simple. It's even an improved version of that. It's just rook g6 and take the rook, right? King moves, it doesn't matter where, let's say f7 maybe makes more sense. We trade, and we take here. And as we discussed, this is a draw. We're perfectly in time to run. We only need to be careful at the precise moment to play h5. Now, if white wants to prevent that and plays h5 himself, then we're already too close to the king, and there's never gonna be a win here. So rook g6, rook takes e6, immediate draw. That was not played, and I guess both sides were not calculating the endgame with the rook trade, because for both sides this option escaped, and here. So h5 was winning, but rook e7 check was played, which is a mistake, because after king takes b6, obvious move, rook takes h7, obvious move too, because that was the reason of giving up b6, we get to this position that it's again a draw. Now, how do you draw this? This is a not so obvious draw, I would say. But it's also a not so obvious win if white tries to win. So it's complicated. Anyway, rook f1 was played, which is the correct move. So good kudos to J123 here. Rook f1 check. King g6. And. Rook g1 check, so that's good. We keep checking. So first idea is to check forever. White can try to get rid of those checks in two ways. One is walk in front of the pawn, and he did that. The other would be to try and go to the back rank and then stop the checks with the rook, but then the rook can go behind the pawn. The rook will need to go there, and we have time to approach our king because the pawn is frozen until... You know, white needs to maneuver a lot. So that's one plan. There's another plan that doesn't quite work because our king is in the wrong side here. If our king was back, we would have the Vankura technique to save this position, but we can't. We can't. So that's also maybe something that's in the mind, or should be in the mind of the players, that if, for instance, this rook ever goes to the back rank and we play king b7, we can bring the rook to the c-file and have the Vankura defense. But okay, that did not happen, and it can't happen right now if white keeps this king cut. So anyway, rook g1, good move. King h6 was white's attempt in front of the pawn, makes sense. And now black plays the only move that draws, and black found it, king c6. So the plan now is to run, run close, and white will try to, you know, push the pawn. And a rook pawn is very hard to win with it, but the defender also needs to be precise. So it's kind of an interesting fight, and I think what most players know is that if you have the defender king close enough, it's a draw. So yeah, running towards that side is like the right idea. Rook e7. I think both players are actually bearing that fact in mind, and that's the reason the king started running, and that's the reason rook e7 was played. The idea is to cut the king as far as possible. So king d6, and rook e2, all logical moves, and king d7, also logical move. So far both sides are playing more or less correct here. H5. Yeah, and in this position, was in this position the mistake or next? I think it was in the next position. In this position, if I was black, I would just stay put. And to stay put, I think the king is ideal. To me, the king is ideal. It's as far as we're allowed, but also on the seventh rank. I think seventh and eighth rank are like, you know, the ranks to be on. So I don't quite understand this move, king d6, which was played like a waiting move, I suppose, but you have rook g3, you have rook g4. I don't understand king d6, even though it's still a draw, and it's still a draw. It feels rather suspicious, because at some point, allowing the rook to the back rank is going to be a mistake. For now, the pawn is still too far, so white needs to first bring the pawn closer, and he does so with king h7. Now king back to d7, now h6. All right. And now, now this was a very, very, very critical moment where, again, I think the king is ideal on d7, and the drawing moves were, none of them was played. The drawing moves were rook f1, which is kind of weird. But the point is, if the king goes out of that cage on the h file, we have rook g1 check again. So, but that's like a computer idea or database idea. Let's say it's not what a human would do. A human would keep the king cut in front of the pawn, right? So the drawing moves other than rook f1 were rook g3, rook g4, and rook g5. When your king is ideal, don't move it. So black moved the king here and lost. Yeah. So yeah, your king is ideal. Just do waiting moves with the rook. The rook usually has more waiting moves than the king. And the king here, the problem is, if you go to d6, he went to d8, which makes a bit more sense of than king d6. Because as I said earlier, king d6 allows rook e8. And now that would be a problem. Because, yeah, now rook g8 is coming, rook g6 or rook g7 next, king go, yeah, and promotion. So we will lose control of e8, that's bad news. But king d8 was played, and that lost control of e6, which is maybe not as obvious because people are usually, people are used to the rook g8 maneuver, but it does work on g6 as well, and or g7. Really, white wants the rook on one of those squares. And now, kudos to Leon88, by the way, who found the only winning move, rook e6. And now, well, rook a1 was played, because now it's already desperate. If king d7, rook g6 will happen, and it's going to be a loss. So here, I think black realized that and tried rook a1, tried to go for something different, but... also lost pretty quickly. Here, h7 does not win, by the way, because after takes promotion, there's rook a8, so you have to first save the rook. I wonder why the rook didn't keep the king cut, but I guess the king is too far anyway. Rook g6, check, king g7, and the game is over. Yeah. And rook g8. He didn't resign yet. He resigned here. Okay, so that was that. And I have three more examples. Next one is from the game Ross067 against thiccclouds. And let's move on to move 26, black. This position. Okay, this is not an endgame. This is a... well, it's close to an endgame, but not an endgame yet. So this one is more of a tactical idea, or a... Actually, if I remember correctly, this is an idea that shouldn't work, and it did work. So I guess one of the sides made a terrible mistake here. So, okay, black is threatening... I mean, black is breaking on a4. And actually, pawn takes b3 is a relevant threat because the rook is undefended on a1. So you either defend it with bishop d2 or bishop b2. Bishop b2 allows a3, so I'm not sure. You either connect rooks ready to recapture on b3, or you address that threat somehow. You can also play rook b1 and then take back, or... Yeah, I don't know. You have to do something. B takes a4, maybe. But white played a very, very strange move. King h1. King h1, preparing an idea that's very suspicious. So black took on b3, and I think that's correct. You have to punish your opponent. Your opponent didn't defend against that. You take it. But next move shows what the idea was, I think. So what's the idea of king h1? Well, obviously, I think obviously, maybe not so obvious, but the only thing that can explain a move like that, you know, completely giving up on the queen side, is to use the g file to attack. So rook g1 is going to come, maybe then bishop h6. Problem is, it doesn't really work. So a takes b3, good move. And now rook g1 was not played. But if rook g1 was played, threatening bishop h6, black could do many things here, really. For example, I mean, rook takes, even rook takes h2. I'm not saying that's the best move. There's another threat, by the way, queen g4, not just bishop h6. But rook f7, bishop f8, it looks like we're going to have enough moves to defend g7 and even g6. So if we have a defense, I guess we can play something else on the other side of the board without any problems, including, I mean, rook fb8, because bishop f8, also the queen is defending. Bishop d6 already starting to defend. Those are great moves, but even simpler moves, like give that pawn back just to trade a lot of material the pawn is promoting, so you have to take it. And this position is so beautiful for black. White is in terrible shape. So that could have been one way to win, to play rook takes a2 after rook g1. And white here played an even stranger move. Instead of rook g1, which seemed like the idea of king h1, he played bishop h6. So it's trying to be trickier. It's trying to be trickier. It's saying, now if you take my bishop, I'm going to bring the rook, but with check. And my answer to that would be, so what? So I would take the bishop here. And black took the bishop, actually. Again, you have all the moves here. Again, rook takes a2. Again, b takes a2. Even game b2 is a move. Many moves are there here. Because, for one, bishop h6 doesn't threaten anything. It's like, I'm sacrificing my bishop, please take it, so I have a file to attack you. But there's no real threat. If we don't take the bishop, the most the bishop can do is to be sacrificed on g7. And I don't think that's much different from us taking the bishop. Anyway, taking the bishop is not a problem, so black took it. Why is it not a problem? Because rook g1 check, we can just move the king to h8. Of course, you have to calculate that because there are two legal moves, and one of them, king f7, hangs queen h5 mate. So, okay, yeah, we can go wrong on the light squares because we're very strong on the dark squares. Let's not blunder a checkmate on the light squares. But king h8, pretty natural move, and rook g8 is coming, and black is a piece up. So what's so special about this game? Why am I sharing this with you? because it looks like white played just a stupid sacrifice and gave away the position and that's it, right? However, white won this game, so I thought that was interesting. How did the game continue? Well, white decided to play queen g4, threatening queen g7 mate. Again, there are many different moves to defend here. One of the most natural moves was played, rook g8. But of course, any move of this bishop, the queen will defend g7. So there was bishop g6, bishop c5, bishop b4, even bishop a3. And of course, also rook g8, which attacks the queen, so seems decent and was played. And also, maybe some trades may happen. So here comes the trick, queen e6. Queen e6 without any threat at all, but at least it prevents the queen trade. And now, now black decided it was a good moment to blunder. Well, actually this move is not the blunder, the next one is, but if I was in this position, I would not play the move that black played here. What would you play as black here? I mean, there are many interesting moves. I think a move that's very good, can't be bad, is b2. The point being, white has no threat whatsoever. It's attacking g8, but g8 is defended. So white has no attack. It's attacking the bishop that's defended. It's attacking the pawn that's defended. We need to be careful because our king is trapped in the corner. That's the only thing we need to be careful about, to defend the important squares around our king so there's no checkmate. And honestly, I would have kept this rook here, which is doing a pretty good job defending everything, and it is defended. So I would have used this moment to maybe play b2, which is completely winning, to play maybe b takes a2, which is completely winning. What we don't need to blunder is something like rook takes a2 when we blunder a mate on g8. That did not happen, by the way. But for instance, if pawn takes a2, rook takes a2, we don't take on a2 because we hang mate, but we trade on g1 first, then we take on a2, and we win. So b takes a2 is winning, b2 is winning. If we want to be more clever, queen takes e4 is winning. Because even if we hand the bishop, then queen takes d5 is going to be checkmate. So many moves win here for black. But he decided to trade on g1, which, again, is not the final mistake, but it's already giving away some things, right? It's giving away the g-file completely. Now we can't go rook g8. We can't go rook g8 anymore. So we gave away the g-file, and that implies not just the g8 square, but also the g7 square, and that's what black missed here. Black missed that the g7 square now is gone. We had it defended. Notice how the rook defends g7. What I mean by that is if white gets queen f7 in, that wouldn't threaten queen g7 mate. Now after the trade, if white gets queen f7 in, that threatens queen g7 mate. That's what black missed here, and played a horrible blunder here. Horrible blunder. B takes a2. And now white has forced checkmate. So how to ruin a game that, you know, your opponent sacrifices, I don't want to say for no reason, but very unsoundly, and you need to be careful about your opponent's threats. When your opponent sacrifices, and first of all, he's going to be material down. So stop the threats and you will be winning. Here black missed queen f7. And honestly, if it was me, a long time ago already, I would have moved this bishop for the queen to come defend. But at this point is way too late. After queen e6 is already too late, because now this bishop needs to guard so many squares. So after queen f7, which, by the way, was found by White. So congratulations to Ross, who found this this kill. Of course, he was looking for it, so it was easier for him to see them for his opponent. Yeah, and the game is over. Queen g7 mate is coming, and the bishop can't really move. If the bishop moves to d8, there's mate on g8, or f8, or e8. And otherwise, if the bishop moves somewhere else, then queen takes f6 with mate. So that's what happened in the game, by the way. Bishop d6, queen takes f6, and black resigned. So, yeah, interesting tactics. White did a very tricky sacrifice, and it worked out well on the light squares, because black didn't defend precisely. Again, at this point, I would have moved the bishop, because that, you know, let's put it somewhere safe. Here looks safe, because there's also bishop c3 ideas. Now, we're defending that, not just that, now the queen is ready to defend, like any queen a6, we can play queen f7, we can keep it all safe around the king. And there were many, many, many options, different options to defend. And this is the thing with chess. We usually focus a lot when we analyze with an engine. We focus a lot on the mistake where the engine says we were winning and we're no longer winning. So people would focus too much on the move pawn takes a2 here, which of course is the final blunder, and of course black is winning. I don't get me wrong, black is winning here. The problem is here, black already gave away so many, made so many mistakes in a row that now defending is not so easy as it was before. Because now black is winning, yes, but you need to be very precise, because queen f7 is coming. And if you move the bishop, you're allowing either queen takes f6 with checkmate or queen e8 with checkmate, so you can't move the bishop. So how do you defend here? It's tricky. Queen f7 will come. You can't prevent it. Well, actually, you can. So the only move that prevents it, rook f8, would have bigger defense here. And the other move, which is not that obvious maybe, is queen d8, because it allows queen f7, but then we're just in time to defend g7. So at this point, black needed to do a very precise move to survive already, which of course it's a move you can find, but you already made your life difficult. So let's put it that way. So yeah, we focus too much on the final mistake when we analyze with a computer, but for example here, there's absolutely no reason to trade on g1. I don't understand that move. Even though the position still winning, it's only winning if you find the precise defense next. Why would we make our life so difficult? I think when you're a piece up, you should actually be looking to make your life easier, not difficult. Why giving away the g file? If there's one scenario where we're gonna get checkmated, we're making all the steps to go into that scenario. So I think black here was a bit shooting themselves in their foot. Like rook takes g1 makes no sense to me. Computer says that's winning too, but know what I mean? Okay, so very interesting. Let's move on. Next example I bring is from the game Karpyan against Ryzalis. Let's move on to the position after move 42 black, which is this one. Oh yeah, this is one of my favorite endgames, knight versus bishop. And well, it's an interesting position. Black is a pawn up, and not just a pawn up, but black has two passed pawns, right? And white has no passed pawns, and white is a pawn down. Now, the good news for white is white has the bishop. Bishop is better than knight in positions with pawns in both sides of the board because the bishop is faster than the knight. And also, the pawns are on the wrong color for the knight. From the knight's perspective, black would prefer to have the pawns on light squares, not on dark squares, because on dark squares, they're all targets for this bishop. So I'd say this position is probably a draw. Probably. But I think white may have some winning chances. Of course, black also may dream with some winning chances because of, you know, two passed pawns. But the king is really far away. So let's see what happened in this game, because I can't remember. B4 was played. Okay, B4 was played, and I think that's a good move. It's already threatening to have a passed pawn. And if you take, and we take with the bishop targeting this pawn here, the knight will have to go to a defensive spot. You can't probably defend from e4 because you're going to get attacked. Although maybe after... No, knight e2 is covered. Yeah, you can't probably do that. You're going to have to go passive. And I would expect a draw there. c5 can happen next. So white is actually doing it well. c takes b4 wasn't played, by the way. But... yeah, it's doing a good job. If bishop here, there's knight e8, and then it's a bit annoying. But after b4, you know, the normal move would be to trade, because this is going to be a very dangerous passed pawn. So you take, this targets that, there's no knight e4, because the knight has to go away, and okay, you can still defend from f7, but why giving up this tempi to the king, right? So you probably have to go knight e8 here, and here, at the very least, I think white was probably ready to play c5. The more pawns you trade, the easier it's going to be to draw. Even a pawn down, bishop versus knight, should be a draw. So white is doing it very well when he played b4. However, black here decided it was a good moment to blunder and play king g7, which, positionally speaking, is a move you want to do. You want to bring the king, so good job. But there was a big threat to have a passed pawn here. You should have stopped that threat, and he didn't, so white played b5, which is completely winning. Now, this game ended in a draw, so let's see how white messed this up after this. This is completely winning. This is completely winning. This passed pawn should win the game. Anyway, knight d7 was played, b6, good move. And how do you stop b7, bishop c7, and get a queen, get a knight? b7, e4. Ah, now I remember. Now I remember. This was a critical moment, because black made the wrong decision not taking on b4, right? Remember? Instead of taking on b4, brought the king with king g7. Now, what black is doing correctly is he's being consistent with his plan. Remember that saying, it's better a bad plan than no plan. So the plan was bad, because you should have taken the pawn instead of, you know, when the pawn reaches b7, now you regret not taking it. But okay, the plan was wrong. But at least now he's following the plan, bringing the king. And now e4... has one clear idea in mind, which is keep bringing the king. This pawn is not going to promote. You know, this king is on g2, so the only reason to play e4 is to play king d4, I mean king e5, king d4. And now, if we take these pawns, we have... we saved the game, because we're never going to lose. So the knight is ready to be sacrificed for this queen on b8. So here... I think there was only one move that made sense for white to win the game, and it was not played. So white gave it away here. And if you want, you can pause the video and think what you would play as white here. And the move, well, you need to stop king d4. So the only way to do that would have been king f2, because now king e5 can be met with king e3. And there's always time to play bishop c7 and b8. There's nothing, absolutely nothing black can do to prevent that. Now, maybe white could be concerned that doing this allows this pawn to run. But okay, the good news is that those are 5 tempi, so we have plenty of time. And we have plenty of time because, again, a bishop is very fast. So let's imagine h5 happens. We have the chance to go bishop c7 and then b8. Or we can first stop the pawn, which would be my choice, probably bishop d8. And now black is in Zugzwang. Black can't move the knight. Black can't advance this pawn because we take it. Then we go back to d8, c7. So black has to play king f5 because that's pretty much the only move that keeps e4 defended. And after king e4, this is clever. We can go bishop c7 because now we're also targeting this pawn. So we win a tempo there with bishop d8, bishop c7, because here black's best try is to go back there and then push the pawn. But we won a tempo there. And let's say we promote. Take, take, and now h4. The simplest way to win, actually it's the only way to win. Okay, pause the video and tell me what's the only way to win. Sorry, I'm checking a message from work. All right. What's the only way to win for white here? Very simple. Yes, bishop takes d6. Sacrifice the bishop for 2 pawns. We're in the square of this pawn, and we have an advanced passed pawn, defended passed pawn. It's a win. So that would have been a way to win. Bishop is so powerful. And of course, we don't need to commit to bishop c7. We can do it any moment. We can play around with, like, for example, bishop h4 would have been another win. If we don't calculate, if we don't see the bishop takes d6 sacrifice, we can play around as much as we want because this is such a winning position. This knight can't move at all. The only move it has to prevent promotion is going there and then going back to d7 or to a6 and then go back to b8. That's everything the knight can do. And in the meantime, we can move the bishop and maybe try to Zugzwang, you know, by preventing this pawn from moving, we can try to Zugzwang this king. And here, for instance, we're already winning this pawn. And if king f5 is not played, well, you can lose the tempo with the knight. Now let's do this. And now for the, I mean, just bishop takes d6. Yeah, like everything wins, so. So you don't need to go fancy and find bishop d8, bishop c7, bishop takes b8, and then the sacrifice, bishop takes d6. You can just play around. This is a horrible position for black. Instead, but it was important to prevent king d4, otherwise you don't win. Yeah. So instead in the game, bishop c7 was played, which, yeah, it may win a piece, but it may not win the game. So white won the piece and basically drew the game because... yeah, now black can never lose because white has no pawns. Actually, I would argue black can even try to win here with 3 pawns for the piece. 3 pawns that are split. It should be a draw. It is a draw. But now you need to be careful. Remember Shirov Topalov, you know, 3 pawns. The king has to block. Probably the king has to stop one of them. The bishop has to block the other two. But, yeah, apparently there was never danger, I think. King up, good move. Now black tries to win the tempo to go to the other side of the pawn, but it doesn't really make a difference. Bishop there. You know, one thing that you can also try as a defender... At some point, let me find some point. Yeah, that pawn was defended all the time. So let's go back there, back there, back there, and here. Bishop h4 was played. Bishop h4 is kind of a strange move because it gives king g4 tempo, but king g4 is not winning. Yeah, one thing you can try as a defender is when a pawn is on the square, on the color of your bishop, you attack it. So you're forcing it to push, and then you can block it on that dark square on the next move. Here, I imagine King D4 is the easiest, but you can already try things like Bishop B4. You probably don't want to allow H4. Maybe that's a way to lose, actually. But yeah, common theme would be to attack and then try to block. In this case, I think King D4, King D2. Maybe also Bishop D6 bring to this diagonal, and then this king tries to target that. I mean, King D4 already wins the pawn, so then fighting against two pawns, it's very easy. But okay, Bishop H4 was played, which is not bad. Check. There. The pawn advanced anyway. Yeah, here I'm not sure about Bishop H4. But I guess the idea is to attack it, if he's pushed to attack it, force the push and King D2. The problem is King C4. Are you then in time to take on E4? Yes, you are, because this pawn is too far. This pawn was closer, could be tricky. So Bishop F6, King D2. Yeah, here, I mean, black's last try would have been this, which hangs this pawn. Then this. Then the bishop needs to stop it. Bishop b2 would have been my choice probably, but there's bishop b5, and then h4 is like the last attempt of black. But of course, the bishop is already covering c1, and this king is in the square of this pawn, so it's a draw. In the game, the pawn was pushed and lost immediately, and yeah. That's game over. They agreed to a draw here. But yeah, very interesting ending where white could have won with a little patience and again stopping counterplay. Here, there was no need to rush bishop c7, b8. There was the need to stop king e5, king d4, and white would have been winning. Okay, let's have a look at the final position I bring today, which is Victor. It's from the game wiktor-chomik versus Bo Cheng Sile. And let's go to move 43 black, which is this position. We have another endgame. This is the final, the last one we're going to see. And, you know, this position should not be anything special for any side particularly. I feel like each side has its own weaknesses and materially is equal. The kings are both, I think, correctly placed in correct spots. There's only one open file, and this king is, you know, controlling some squares, so there's no way for black's rook to infiltrate, and this black king is doing the same pretty much. Now, of course, there are some breaks here, so some other file may be open, but right now for white is a bit complicated, the pieces are a bit uncoordinated, and black's pieces are also a little passive. Maybe this knight will go soon to attack e3, and ideally bring a rook to f2, that would be so nice if white allows it, but of course white doesn't need to allow it. If any, I think... white should be the preferred side here, although my opinion, this should be a draw in practical play. The engine likes black, likes white, but starting only with rook a3, for instance, not starting with knight c1. So there are some subtleties here, because I of course would play knight c1 and rook a3, a combination of those two, and the reason is, the best counterplay we have is against black's weakness on b7. So we want rook a3 to play rook b3. So we want to move also the knight. And the best use we have to the knight is to stop black's counterplay. And what is our worst weakness? This one on e3, of course. So we need to be careful about both ideas, knight f6, knight g4, and rook f8. Rook f3, that would be annoying, right? Rook f8, rook f. Rook f3 is also 9. So the perfect combination is rook a3, defending already e3. So if the knight lands on g4, no problem. And for this knight to go to the f4 square, knight c1, knight e2. So we can play knight f4 check and block the f file. And then we put a rook on b3, targeting this pawn. Then we will be doing fine. We will be doing actually quite nice. And that would be my plan. But of course, it's not the other plan. You can play more safe. But I mean, that's the most safe, actually. But if you don't see that, maybe you can play in a different way. Maybe you can put the knight here, which prevents rook f3 forever. I mean, forever, as long as you leave the knight there forever as well. And again, rook a3 could be to stop knight takes e3. But of course, rook f2 is also a threat there, so probably not the best defense. But yeah, you have to see your possible ideas of attacking. Like rook b3 is interesting, but most importantly, you should look at your opponent's threats. And I think white is doing more than fine here. But black won the game. So let's see how that happened. And of all the moves that I can think of in this position, like knight c1, rook a3, even knight e2, which seems rather suspicious, but I could think of that. I could think of rook a1 to go to f1 to contest the file. I could think of, I don't know, I'm running out of normal ideas. But of all the moves I can consider, I would never have guessed white's move, really. I think it's such a bad move. And I wonder why players play this kind of move. But I mean, if we want to improve as players, we need to look at ourselves and decisions like this and try to understand why we make a move like this and how can we fix it. Because this move makes no sense at all to me, and I'm trying to understand why the move was played. So the move was king h3. And in my eyes, the only explanation I can find is that he maybe was trying to play g4. That's the only thing I can think of. Although it's a very suspicious idea, because we're trying to open the king side when we have all the pieces uncoordinated on the other side of the board. So this even the idea g4 seems suspicious. And of course, black doesn't even need to allow it, because knight f6 is like the obvious follow-up. But even if that happens, it looks horrible for this king and this pawn. So I don't understand king h3. It's giving away the squares the king was controlling. It's such a bad move, and it's not fixing the coordination problem with these pieces that are not really doing anything. So black played well. Knight f6 was played, and here white already tried to fix this problem with the pieces, played knight to a1, which again is also a bad move. As I mentioned a move ago, we need to find a good square for this knight, and a good square again would be going to f4. So a good square would have been knight c1. Of course, now black has some initiative that we shouldn't have allowed, but we can still try our best here. And the problem with rook a3 now, defending e3, is that now it's a one move too slow, because we're getting checkmated. So probably we have to give up the e3 pawn here in this line. We didn't need to give it up if we hadn't played king h3. But after king h3, knight g4, we can probably do this and still survive, because we're blocking the f file. Now we may have this tempo to go to b3 and start having at least an active rook, an active knight, blocking the f file. This is what you should be looking for. Even if you make a bad move like king h3, you need to still find, and I think I would say especially if you do a bad move, then you need to maximize what you get of the rest of the pieces. A move like knight a1, that's not gonna make it. That's not gonna make it. That's a horrible knight, and it has no really good prospects. Where is the knight going? To c2? So, okay, I think white was trying to move the knight to a square. This is what I think the player thought. I think the player thought the natural move is knight e2, but then if I want to bring the rook, by pushing the b-pawn, the knight is in the way. So let's put it on the first rank, then I'll push the pawn, then I'll bring the rook. I think that's what he thought, probably. Now, if you think that, why not knight c1? That's question number one. Question number two is, if you think that, why not rook a1? Why doing a strange move with the knight, then a second move with the pawn, when you can bring the rook immediately with rook a1 without having to move the knight and the pawn? So, okay, can we claim time travel? No, we can't. He had 22 minutes, the opponent had 9. So, yeah, I think this is a... I hope it is instructive for the player to learn about to learn from these mistakes, because now it's horrible. Knight g4 and rook f8 is coming so fast, and e3 is hanging, and everything's terrible. Now knight c2 was played, which maybe was the idea of the previous knight a1 move, to defend e3 from c2. Which raises the question, going back to the initial position, if you're really looking for a square to defend this pawn with the knight, which, again, it's much better to bring the knight to f4, but okay, if you're looking for a square to defend this pawn, why not keeping the king here defending f1? Why not bringing the knight to f1? And then, let's say you're concerned about the rook f2 idea, because you put the knight in a passive square, now you have the rook to defend that. So, yeah, I guess, okay, let's go, I went too much back. So king h3 makes so little sense. And then knight a1, okay, knight c2. And this is like the worst, coordination ever. Rook f8, this is already resignable. But it's really hard to suggest a move. Rook f2 is coming, and that will threaten checkmate, and it will hit the knight. So it's definitely resignable, this. He played before rook f2, and he resigned. Yeah. It's, yeah, completely reasonable. So this is yet another case of a player shooting themselves in the foot. I was thinking now that if this was bullet and you give me this position as white, I can't even. No, I was thinking of something that doesn't work. Yeah, if there was no a pawn, if this pawn was gone, I was trying to make knight b4 work, but it's not even working. Terrible. And one move ago. It's the same. Yeah. It's not even There's nothing. There's nothing to do here. If this pawn didn't exist, this pawn a4 didn't exist, we could try knight b4 here. Now imagine this position without this pawn. And after rook f2. Oh well, here we have to play a move. Let's play this. Let's make it like that. No. I need to spend a tempo. I cannot even make a position that for the trick to work. It's terrible. So let's spend a tempo. This is the trick I wanted. B3, bam. And even here, black wins. But this is a stalemate. There was not even a way to dream about something like that in the game. How to shoot yourself in the foot? It's really sad because I think this position. H4 was not necessary. Also, if we go one move ago, here he played H4. You know, when you have a 2-1, you can dream with having a pass pawn one day. After you play h4, you can't dream of having a pass pawn unless you give up a pawn. So that's already not the best decision thinking about a future king and pawn endgame. Just leave them this way. And of course, you gave up the g4 square, which turned out to be very relevant. H4 already not the most precise continuation when you had problems to solve here, but then king h3 and everything else, knight a1, knight c2, when you start doing strange moves, then you lose. Which, by the way, brings me to the topic of studying endgames versus studying openings. When you do strange moves in the opening, sometimes they work out. When you do strange moves in the opening, many players don't properly punish them. And if they do, you still have a long game ahead, you still have the middle game, many things can happen, you still have the end game. When you do strange moves in the end game, you're lost. That's it. There's no coming back. So yeah, the end game definitely a phase of the game that affects the outcome of the game more than the opening. So guys, stop studying openings. Stop wasting your time. Most of the things you're studying with the openings will never happen on the board. Or even worse, will happen in 2 years from now when you will not remember what you studied. So it's a waste of time to study and memorize openings and opening lines. Study endgames. They repeat that you're going to have the same endgames over and over. Stop doing these mistakes. That was my rant of the day. The video, I wanted to make like a 1 hour video. It was 1 hour, 8 minutes, so not that bad. I hope to see you soon. I'll be sharing more interesting positions from this league. Bye bye.